incredibly excited to have with us Jeff Jonas. Jeff is one of only 92 IBM fellows in the world and is the chief scientist of context computing at IBM. Maybe for the audience, it would be helpful to start just by talking a little bit more about the work you're doing now at IBM.
So over my life, when I build stuff, it's just because somebody comes to me and says, hey, can you build this? We can't seem to buy one somewhere. So it's been somewhat random. It's like a locust. I don't know if you know this, but locusts have no directional control. If you create a fire line and put like 100 locusts and then they go, it's hot, half jump in. Okay, so I've just been kind of just whatever pops up in front of me, I somehow become curious and interested in it and attack it like it's fun. I somehow figure out how to make it fun. Well, the casinos came to me and said, we want to make sure we're not transacting with people on the exclusionary list. And people that show up here are doing funny stuff. They're changing their identities, they're stealing other people's identities, but we really have an obligation to keep them out. And so working with their head of corporate security that was former an SAC for the FBI, I built them the system that became known as NORA, non-obvious relationship awareness. Not a widely known thing, but they gave me 90 days to build this. Because of the impossibility of that, it led to some compromises and some necessity, and we generalized the problem in a way where it didn't matter how many data sources they have, good guys or bad guys, but we made the feed into it the same. We treated their operational systems like sensors. Everybody's applying for jobs because they wanted to see who's trying to climb over the fence. Everybody with current jobs terminated employees because they know the policies and procedures and the people. Everybody that enrolled in the slot club, everybody that got casino credit, made hotel reservations, and then 18 different lists of watch list type entities. And they were running this to figure out where to focus their finite attention. And this ultimately, we started catching fascinating things like vendors related to the accounts payable manager. I remember going to the head of the security department and showed them that they had 24 VIPs who were really professional cheaters. And one of them, they had realized they had bought the plane ticket for to fly them back in. I mean, they're flying the cheaters in. And it was ultimately this ability to catch what I would call weak signal, where they're using different socials and different dates of birth. And that was what caught the eye of InQtel. And then I've iterated over that a number of times to make systems able to do thousands of data sources and tens of billions of records. And then this led me to about 5 years ago, maybe six, maybe seven, good God, how old am I? I thought that was my inside voice.
Last cycle.
Yeah. But another executive came to me and said, if you had a big idea, we'd fund it. And I thought to myself, if I could build one more thing in my life, like one, what would it be? So I codenamed it G2. I called it a Skunkworks project, like when they built the stealth bombers, it was a Skunkworks, you know? And so for 2.5 years, I didn't tell anybody I was really building it. I had a very small number of employees. But the purpose of it was to do this kind of thing with data finds data, but be agnostic to whether it's a people, company, car, boat, plane, or asteroid, and do it in Chinese and Thai and Korea and English and Spanish all at the same time, and make it geospatially aware. And so then I've been testing it out there. I call it sea trials, but I've used it to help modernize voter registration in America. I've used it to help the Singaporeans protect the Malacca Strait. We're half the world's oil supply and a third of the world's commodities. And most recently, using it to reduce false positives in AML systems, but it's the same widget.
Wow. That's amazing.
Very exciting for me.
Now, was that the same core of technology that you used for the famous, 21 movie, the Las Vegas?
No, those are slightly different, but they're easily blurred into one. So the NORA class technology is meant to take the structured data from a wide range of sensors and then fuse it and make recommendations about who you should be paying attention to.
That's amazing. That's very interesting. When you think about, there's so much data in the world, and it's obviously growing, and you look at the opportunities that are there, there's also the other side of it, which is, how much do we need to think about privacy? I know that you've written quite a bit, and you've mentioned that you work with a number of the different agencies, and certainly in the U.S. and probably around the world, really helping think through not just how to use this as great solutions to catch people that are doing bad things, but how do we also think about it from a protective perspective?
I'm a really late bloomer to privacy. Yeah. I didn't even know the word privacy. I couldn't even have told you about that while I was in the casino business doing this. I was just helping them, chasing down widgets, right? Mm. Run off and fix this, do this, do that. It was only after I was working on a DARPA program on total information awareness with John Poindexter did I become like acutely aware that, that privacy was a bigger story. But I've become really fascinated. If you want to build sustainable systems, you have to build them in ways. In fact, I'm going to right now reduce everything I've learned about all my interactions with the privacy community down to the fewest number of words, and that is avoid consumer surprise. If what you're doing is likely to or possible to cause consumer surprise to be on the headline of the paper, it's, you probably should think about other ways to do it. Mm. And the reason the privacy community has let me get in so close and sit at their table is I just tell them I'm building stuff you might hate, but I'm trying to build it better. So I've been focused on a method or a body of work called Privacy by Design, where before you even start, in fact, when I was working on my G2 in the beginning, mm-hmm. I'm thinking to myself, what are the primary privacy things you could build into a system? And I made a complete list of everything I could think of, and then I made sure it was designed in from the beginning. And I'll just give you one simple example. I had found a watch list in Washington that had no attribution. I mean, they didn't know where it came from. There was no pedigree. But if you don't know where the piece of data came from, like, how could that be anything but arbitrary? So I baked into this that there's no such thing in handing it a record without a pedigree. And there's no, at no time do two records merge to one where you can't find the full pedigree. Mm. And when you do that, it allows somebody, if you, we periodically find people that don't belong on a watch list. They didn't belong, as careful as we are. When you take somebody off a watch list, how many times do you think that watch list was copied and how far down the ecosystem did it go? And if you don't maintain full attribution through the ecosystem, you can't stop the harm on an innocent. So I've used the word data tethering some to say when you add or change or delete the record here, it does that through the ecosystem. So those are a few examples. But
how much is transparency a part of that as well? Or
is it? Here's where there's two edges of the sword here. One is the thing that I believe is the most agreement between government surveillance mm-hmm. and the privacy community, like where they both go, yes, these are great goals. And that this is where there's the most agreement is everyone hates a false positive. Governments and organizations hate it because it wastes resources, and the privacy community hates it because you're tapping on people's shoulders that are absolutely, utterly innocent. So everyone agrees. Yeah. But if you're trying to catch clever bad guys and you have to have some data they don't know you have, well, if you're overly transparent with all your data, you've just made it so much harder to catch them.
Yeah.
And that's the harder one to square.
Yes.
Yeah.
Very interesting. You mentioned the asteroid, and we had a chance just before this to talk a little bit. I just thought that'd be great to call you out and maybe see if you could talk a bit about that, because that is certainly a pretty fascinating and fun use of your technology.
It's really related to all of you, because Earth is where you keep your stuff. So I think it could be relevant here and here today at your fine institution. So in my G2 project, one of the projects that I went after was helping the Singaporeans protect the Malacca Strait. And one of the data sets that many organizations have globally is data about where vessels are and how they move. And if you were to take a year of historical data, it's about 1 billion records. And so what I crafted was something called a space-time box. It's just if two things are near each other, you give them the same box number. And so we figure out where every vessel in the world hovers and for how long, and if they're hanging out together, and we do it at really high speeds, so Singapore can figure out what vessel's the most interesting. Well, then the Singaporeans say to me and go, can you add Z? I mean, the only way you get Z on a ship is if it sinks and it's negative. It's just, so I'm like, why Z? And they go, planes. So I add Z so that space-time boxes are three-dimensionals, and then I think to myself, well, how am I gonna go test this? So I go off to the Institute of Astronomy, which is at the University of Honolulu, and sit down with these asteroid hunting people. And I spent a whole day just getting in their head. I don't know anything about their business, and I have to keep saying, can you make it smaller words or draw me a picture? Since I don't know any math either. And what happens is they tell me the story. They go, we take a picture of space. It's a picture. It's photons. It's just shiny dots And we take those dots, and we figure out what dots are always there, and we go, well, those are static. Those are stars or other solar systems. They discard those, and everything left is a candidate of something that's moving. But so often, they can't find another one, so it just becomes an orphan, just a shiny dot. But if they find another dot within 8 to 15 minutes, and they go, oh, that dot is probably that dot, they call it a tracklet, then at 3, it's a track, and you have to get to 6 of these dots before they can use their really big fancy math to compute the orbit. And then they go, yay, it doesn't hit Earth. And then they add it to their inventory of about 700,000 asteroids that don't hit Earth. So I say to them, well, you could anticipate where it's going to be. So later when you're taking a picture, you could kind of know what it should have been there. And maybe it improves your ability to extract what's in that image. And they said, well, you know, it's not always there. Sometimes it's rotated and it's not illuminating the sun because it's an odd shape. Sometimes in the collection array between the silicon where it collects, there's defects or little gaps.
That may matter, right?
May matter. Yes. Well, yes, yes, yes. And the bigger they are, the more it matters.
Exactly.
And then they said, you know, maybe we got the orbit wrong, or they said sometimes asteroids hit asteroids. I go, well, since you know where all the asteroids are going, they don't hit Earth, use your math and just see if they're going to hit each other. And they said it's an n squared problem. And it turned, I didn't realize at the time, but what that really meant is a 10 million computer hour problem. What I said, though, is, well, why wouldn't you do it like this? Blah. And they went, my God, that would work. I'll come back to how in a minute. So what I did is I just grabbed a couple of my research friends in IBM Research. I took my three-dimensional space-time box. I said, hey, use this data this way. And we gave them a 25-year forecast of all the asteroids versus all the asteroids in less than 2,800 compute hours. And in their method, if they spent the 10 million hours, it was going to take them 4,000 hours every time a new asteroid's found. And in my method, it takes 15 minutes. And it's so ridiculously simple. And here it is. Ready?
Yep.
With my bare hands, I would tell you. What you do is they have this old Fortran code that astronomers still use that compute where things are when. And so what we do is we call that, and we take asteroid 1 off this list of 600 some or 700,000. We take asteroid 1 and we go, hey, where is... are you going to be at noon tomorrow? And it comes back, it goes, right here. Now on Earth, it's a lat long and a time, but in space, they call it RA and DEC, mm-hmm. Okay? And a Z from the center of the sun. So they send it to I say, we're going to be tomorrow noon. It comes back and goes, right here. And we go, yeah. What zip code is that? It's just a space-time box of a pretty good size. Then we go to the same asteroid and go, hey, man, we're going to be day after tomorrow at noon. And it goes, right here. And we're like, yeah. What zip code is that? So we just do that on all the asteroids. And on any given day, only 2,000 asteroids are even in the same zip code. Well, that makes the problem smaller. So then we go back to just those two asteroids on the same zip code. If any of you astronomy buffs, 0.05 AU. So we go back to those and we go, hey, where are you going to be at 1 a.m., 2 a.m., 3 a.m., just on that one day? And each time it comes back and goes, here. We go, yeah. What street is that? It's just a smaller space-time box. The total number of asteroids on any given day that are in the same hour on the same street is so small, then you summons the big math. So when I explained this to them, they just looked at me and went, that should work. And I mean, I could see it in my head. I'm like, well, of course it's going to work. And it's funny now, though, because when I talked to astronomers and told them we did all this simulation, they go, well, I got to hear the math, and I just couldn't use any math. Yeah. And they just look disgusted with
it. We want to hear the results. Are we safe for the next 25 years?
Let's see. The good news is probably. No, the bad news. Well, let me say this. In June, they sent me an email that said, this is the first time we've taken your forecast. We looked at a place in space, and we actually watched two asteroids glaze each other within the diameter of Earth from each other. This has never happened before. It helps us estimate the densities of these things. Mm. And next question.
So you've talked a lot about math, and I think you've indicated you have a pretty strong
view. That's all I know about math.
I'd be curious, because you've made some, you've written some blogs and been well known for making the statement that, you know, data beats math effectively. And so, the thinking about data somehow being a more appropriate vehicle for discovering or determination of things. Just love to hear your thoughts on that.
What I really mean when I say data beats math is that point when you're not getting much more out of the math. Like you're really wishing for a much higher quality prediction. And here's the interview question, is you go to the math team and you say, okay, if we can fund you with $5 more million or 10 more people or whatever, some kind of quantity, would you be able to close your error rate in half? And when they answer no, math's not the path. It's figuring out what other data to add. But it's about widening the observation space. Mm. And often it's data you already own, or it's data that you can collect in transactions with customers, or you can
It sounds as much about methodology and thinking as it is about science. I mean, I know that probably understating the amount of true effort and science that goes into this, but.
To me, it's just really simple. And for me, there are things in my work where I have to rely on others that do math and do the big heavy lifting. Yeah. Most everything that I can dream up are just absolutely simple. And that's just for me. It's just embarrassingly simple. When I have to explain to an astronomer how a three-dimensional space-time box allows you to focus your finite resources so that you can just use heavy math on stuff that even has a chance,
It's amazing. Jeff, thank you very much. Very conscious of your time. It's been an honor and a pleasure.